We now have Sri K. Venugopalakaru for our next session on machine learning and deep learning methods for cybersecurity applications. Sri Venugopalakaru has done his master's in information technology, PG diploma in telecommunication technology, and special engineering diploma in electronics and communication. Sir has received awards like Digital Circle of Excellence, Best IT Work, Hall of Fame, etc. Sir is a senior executive managing with management business consultant with 25 years experience with extensive subject matter expertise in IT lifecycle management, IT governance, project management, business operation management, stakeholder management, leadership coaching, and developing cost-effective solutions to meet customer business requirements. Sir, it's an honor to welcome you on behalf of KMIT. Over to you, sir.
Okay, before we get the presentation ready, Dr. Prabhu, Dr. Rajshekar, fellow speakers, all the academic luminaries, stalwarts, and all the enthusiasts, I thank you all for this opportunity. Yeah. So it's very exciting. I know I stand between lunch and you. So the onus is on me to make it more interesting and exciting, if possible, more thrilling also. Okay, we are talking about an impact of cybersecurity and its damage that it can cause to the world in terms of $6 trillion. If you all put together the big five companies, you know, the Apple, the Amazon, the Microsoft, the Facebook, and you know, all these big five put together, their economy doesn't stand more than 9 billion. Market capitalization. Now we are talking about a parallel economy which is run, which is as much as $6 trillion, and it is growing exponentially day in and day out. So what does it mean to us? It means that there are so many people who are very, very learned, experts in their own field, and trying to lean towards this particular industry, right? What does it cost for a day in the world? It's about 190,000 per second. Can you imagine the amount of loss that all of us put together? Be it an industry, be it an organization, be it an individual, we're all losing a second, $190,000. What has been the company is doing over the years? For the last 7 years, we have spent around $1 trillion to manage security loopholes in the organizations, and also, of course, individually. We all have a lot of you know, software tools, etc. We manage you know, subscriptions, whatever. So this $1 trillion is being spent, but how much of it is really securing us today? Are we 100% secured? As per Gartner, it's only 95% success. Because of one reason, the enemy is much faster. As Dr. Prabhu mentioned, we are not able to catch up with the enemy. So what do we need to do? So that's what we are going to discuss in a couple of slides, wherein if you see the global cybersecurity expenditure, it's going into around 430 or 60 billion dollars in 2022 expected to be, and in India it's expected to be around $3 billion in 2022. And compared to the previous years, while industry or global average is around 15% growth, we are spending around $3 billion, expected to spend around $3 billion in 2022, which is around 18%. The industry average or the global average is around 14%, right? So that is still a growth. Everybody is, you know, spending that. It's a grudge purchase, if you call it, right? So this is unfortunate, but it's a reality. Okay, this is from the overall IT spending standpoint, the two different perspectives. One is from Gartner and another one is from IDC. What is the average that we are spending from IT overall spending? Gartner projections show that is around 5 to 6% annually from the overall IT spending. Every organization spends for security, wherein IDC gives a little bit more deeper perspective of that. The services are on the top of the layer, followed by the hardware and software. That's how the purchases of this overall $3 billion from India and overall $460 billion from the world, they are spent in those areas usually and broadly. Okay, what is cybersecurity? Can we do something about it? Is fondly called as SPAF, is a professor, US professor. His definition is very simple. You plug off, you put the system in a titanium box and put in a bunker with a nerve gas surrounded by it and with dread armed forces, but still he wouldn't stake his claim on his life, on security. And so why do we spend so much money? We're spending so many billions. So that is to increase our comfort level. Having no security is more expensive than having some security. How much you want to spend? For example, you want to be very safe and you put 10 locks for your main door, right? And it's not easy for you to get into your own house. So the comfort level, that's what you have to see. 2 locks is good, 1 is good, or nothing is good for some people. So that is what you have to decide. We have to decide individually, right? Cybersecurity has two main aspects. One is the security. We have to protect. There is no chance because, you know, cost of not protecting is much higher. So we have to protect. And there is a behavior associated with that. That is all a safety behavior. We can dwell into that a little bit more. What are threats? Threat is a harm that is waiting to happen. You already are stuck with the threat. Then that is a risk at hand, right? Threats are possibilities. How do you manage your threats? We'll look at that. What are vulnerabilities? Vulnerabilities are, there is no system, like, you know, we say nobody is perfect, right? There is no system in the world which is perfect. How many of you know that US Army headquarters were hacked and rendered completely down? Down means, in today's term, when I say it is down, it's not like, you know, it is dismantled or a bomb was, you know, thrown on it. No. The operations were completely made to be unavailable. For example, in this hall, if we don't have audiovisual systems, probably we cannot do and proceed with this session, right? That's how it is. They completely brought down. Last month, Taiwan Parliament was brought down completely, meaning that they could not operate. Nothing which is related to cyber was working in that. It was completely hacked. So what do we do? The basic fundamental hygiene of cybersecurity is, you know, you detect it, you respond it, you try to reflect on it, how do we prevent it, and then you have a system in place which will continuously monitors such events to happen in the future, right? That's a simple hygiene of cybersecurity. So this is in a different way. If you depict it, there are threat agents, there are owners. Threat agents continuously pursue to attack your assets. See, somebody is attacking you, it is not just your computer, he is attacking you personally. Either you know, stealing money from you or your personal data for some harm that it can cause to you. So threat agents continuously look for assets to manipulate and cause threats to exploit vulnerabilities, right? So as one as what we do, we continuously try to take countermeasures and we try to, you know, improve our intelligence and then start putting actions in place to prevent things from happening. On the right side, if you see, you know, I put some nuts and bolts of the different OSI layers, which are very important when you consider cybersecurity. See, the bottommost layer is called physical layer. The second layer is called data link layer, wherein you have so many Ethernet protocols and all that, right? Next is the internet layer, where is the routing happens. The fourth one is very important, which is the TCP layer, the transport layer, wherein if you in your browser, if you say HTTPS, is a transport layer protocol you are using, which means any data that you are sending is being encrypted, right? So, and then you have application and presentation and so on. So at each layer, there is a possibility that you can be attacked, right? It's not just, you know, you make sure your main door is locked. You probably have windows, you have ventilators, you have exhaust, and probably you also have to consider the other, you know, entry points. For rodents and all, they, you know, they enter through the drainage pipes and whatnot, right? So it is just a TCP IP. If you consider a TCP IP address as your house, it has got 65K ports. So you are vulnerable as many times, because an application developer can develop something to exploit any of the ports. So what do you do in a firewall? You normally, you know, disable all the ports and only enable those which are required for your business, right? So I think Dr. Rajshekar has taken us through an exhaustive list of threats which are happening from the global standpoint. An average organization gets per week about 900, that was 2021, and today the threats stand around 1,000 plus per week, an average organization, right? And if you really see the data loss which is happening, the highest contributor is not, you know, internal misuse or some ignorance, it is the cyber attack. And in this 15, if you have to categorize, you know, they randomly keep changing, like stock market, what is the most, you know, highest attack in the offing today. If you see, phishing is a number one attack, because a lot of people are gullible, and you know, many of us have already discussed, phishing is the simplest attack. And most of the educated people who are also working for security industry also fall into this social engineering trap, as we have discussed earlier on. Phishing is the topmost, then web security, web attacks are the next. You hack a bank and you steal millions of dollars, and you make sure that those records are published everywhere to the dark web, and then, you know, anything can happen to you for your information. Then the third one is ransomware. I think we already touched upon ransomware. If you recollect, in 2017, there was something called WannaCry, which actually was, no one could really figure out where it originated from. A bunch of goons from North Korea were experimenting, and this was caught by NSA. NSA had the strain of it, and they were working on it. Another bunch of people, they stole it and they put it in the public, and they don't know how to decrypt it. It was very sad part. many of the people who paid money to completely, you know, what does it do? WannaCry, it completely encrypts your computer. You can't do anything unless you have the key to decrypt the data. Your entire computer, irrespective of what files are there, gets encrypted. You can't open anything. What do you need to do? You need to pay the ransom. How do you pay the ransom? You need to pay in bitcoins or in dollars. Then you probably will get a key. And the key may work, may not work. Unfortunately, they haven't developed the key. Luckily, in 2 days, I mean, the spread was so huge, in 200,000 infections which are recorded actually across 150 countries. And UK health system was completely paralyzed. They have to postpone all the appointments of the patients. That's a kind of a magnitude it struck by a bunch of people who are not computer educated. And the best part is they stole it from the NASA, another party. So we do not have a secured, 100% secure system anyway, ransomware. Then there are so many other things which actually we have discussed already. I don't want to go into that. So the data loss is one of the biggest, you know, concerns we have. This is about an ecosystem. If you talk about cybersecurity, it doesn't stand on its own. It all needs to have some kind of a policy making which is under governance. And the policy also helps us to do a security engineering. An organization cannot have a proper cybersecurity without having to implement that in the engineering phase of the organization. When engineering phase, the design happens, the operations phase has to take over. So they need to have a solid SOP, how we need to, you know, manage the operations. What is the, you know, code of conduct for every employee of the organization, right? So that's what happens. On the other side, if you look at, there are so many other adjacencies which are related to cybersecurity. It is just not about one thing. We have all been discussing that there's a lot of research which is happening on how to manage any kind of a threat related to cybersecurity. Okay? It's a lot of things happening around it, and it's a huge technological science emerging, and we will discuss a little bit more. As I said, you know, I probably will take you some thrillers also. We'll hope we have some thrill because I'm holding you from lunch. Okay. The three types, if you really say the threats are, which is cybercrime, an individual likes to, you know, harm somebody, and he would probably, you know, targeting somebody, that's all about a cybercrime. Cyber attack is mostly driven by political. You see in US elections what happens, what other countries like Russia and all, you know, they perpetuate the cyber crimes. And we also started huge campaigns using electronic media in India for electioneering, right? So we are no different. We are also part and parcel. This is a huge, you know, the political media that actually gets into messaging and opinionating and all that. Cyber terrorism, this is something which we have been seeing. These are actually state driven. Most of them are state driven. Now you probably, you know, I have said the parliament of Taiwan was brought down in August. Most of these are not published usually. Most of these are not published. Some of the, you know, intelligence agencies, they record some you know, events and they produce, but 99% of them are not produced, published because of embarrassment. Okay, what we see is a surface web, you know, the Googles, Amazon, the Yahoos and all what we use normally, the public, we only see the 5% of the overall web actually. The 95% of the web is either deep web or dark web, right? What does the deep web? Deep web probably is okay. There may be some kind of a decent journalism and all that, but deep web is okay because it mostly for patents and other research data and articles, which is only by, you get access only by a justification, right? To do either contribute or draw something, to do something better for the society. But dark web is all the more, it's different. You see, there are tools which are, I just listed a few tools. There are hundreds of those tools which are available in the dark web. You download the Tor browser. Tor stands for the onion root. You just download that and you can get into the dark web and imagine the possibilities are unlimited. Unlimited. I'll tell you what they are. Cybercrime is a service today. It is a service. I develop a code and I successfully hack somebody. I publish that code in the dark web for a price. There's a service catalog if you see. Either you pay for it in bitcoins or in dollars. There is a service catalog. Unbelievable. It's so organized. And who will be manning this dark web activities? Some of the topmost technocrats. Topmost technocrats. Okay. So there is a service. They also provide you consultancy how to do hacking, how to target an individual, how to target, as I said, it's a whaling, phishing, whaling. It doesn't have to be with some CEO. It can be a top-notch media person or a film person, anybody, right? I'm just wanting to trouble somebody. I can just go to this star, the dog website, and subscribe to that tool, and then I'm going to be completely anonymous. Maybe many times the cyber crimes cannot be traced. As Dr. Rajshekar mentioned, there are villages in Bihar where you probably, every one of us must have had some kind of a call, social engineering call, saying that, oh, you ordered something in Amazon, and they know your order, they know what you ordered, so obviously you start trusting them. But only when they speak, continuously speak, lean to speak in Hindi, you start suspecting them, right? And these are, they can just get a tool into their hands and they can really make anyone's life havoc. As simple as that. I'm not trying to make up a story here, and it is a reality today. There's a great saying, right? There's a great saying about, or not great saying, it's a popular saying. Those who know who have been hacked, those who don't know, they have been hacked. But everyone is eventually is hacked. That's a fundamental message. Okay, how these cybersecurity professionals be there, doing white hat or black hat? White hat or black hat? There are two. The line is very thin between them. The morality line is very thin. So there are two people there. Anyone knows who are they? I'll give the names. One is Kevin Mitnick. Other one is Shumo Mura. Have any idea? Any of you have seen a movie called Takedown? Please go and watch it. Kevin Mitnick was number one cybercrime offender in 90s. Number one. He hacked as many as 40 organizations, including IBM and Motorola. And he also hacked somebody who is an NSA agent called Shimomura. And it was a thrilling story, honestly. You should see when you have time. Shimomura and this guy, they play cat and mouse game. And finally, Shimomura gets him. He gets him. And he served 5 years of imprisonment in US. And now he's one of the topmost Now from black hat, he became a white hat. He's one of the top most cyber consultants. Now how a typical cyber crime guy, he doesn't look like this. He looks so lanky, probably leaner, and sitting with some gadget in some corner and doing everything, right? So the traditional, you know, the perceptions have to be changed completely. So let's get into AI, ML and DL. What is AI? I think sir already mentioned, technological science that studies and develops theories, methods, techniques and applications. Underline this, theories, methods, techniques and applications that simulate, extend and expand human intelligence. Some people call it as augmented intelligence, some people call it as expert system, some people call it as autonomous system. So these are evolving actually. Expert system is something, it actually solves a particular problem, very challenging, technical or a deep knowledge problem. So this is a broad sense AI. What is ML? ML is a subfield, if you can see on the right side top, is a field of study that gives computers the ability to learn without being actually programmed to learn. They learn without being actually explicitly programmed. And DL is mimics your brain to solve large problems. It's part of, you know, machine learning. It mimics human brain. Basically, we talk about layers of neurons and neural networks, which are used in deep learning. So some of the key points about all this. So deep learning, it depends, the performance of the system depends on the amount of data you supply. The more the data, the performance is much better. Machine learning, actually, the more data you provide, it tends to tend down towards the performance. The hardware requirement, I mean, DL requires a solid GPU, graphic performance unit, wherein ML doesn't need a solid GPU. So that means hardware requirements are much higher for DL. We talk about, if we talk about the features, ML, you probably need to train the system for, it to understand initially during the training phase and then it starts working. But DL, you don't need to train. It automatically finds the patterns within the data and the structures and will bring out the knowledge. So these are basically the main points about DL and ML. While I just wanted to talk about the learning, how we talked about learning, right? The machine learning system needs the learning. It is like this. You show your kid a mobile phone and a TV and a car. What happens? In the brain, he collects some information about, the neurons collect the information. So normally humans have 100 billion neurons in the brain, and each neuron can have 10 connections, which means you can imagine the number of connections, and each connection can be an impression. So a mobile set is an impression, a TV is an impression, a car is an impression, and it somewhere stays in the memory. One of the Nobel laureates said, the entire brain, left and right, is all nonsense. It's all a simple memory, a chunk of memory. And he got a Nobel Prize early in 90s. He debunked the theory of left brain, right brain, which was, probably another person, stated that theory in 1940s and got a Nobel Prize. So these are evolving things. So the neural network actually simulates your brain and activates the neurons based on the mathematical function that you provide for it. And you know, imagine if you stack number of neurons, it can even outperform human brain, right? That is a reality. Today we have computers which actually can perform, I don't want to take the name, but it's in, you know, general domain. Deep Blue is a computer which actually has beaten Kaspersky in chess game, right? Okay. Deep learning, just how the neurons are connected. You have an input layer, you have multiple hidden layers. Input layer is where you actually provide all the input and data and features. You have a lot of neurons interconnected, and then you have an output. Okay. Typically, you have inputs, and you have a weightage for each of the input, and you apply some bias on top of the weight, add a bias to the, once you input and you multiply with the weight, you add a bias, and you apply that to a transfer function, okay, activation function, we call it, right? For example, you have somebody touches you, you look at it. So there is an activation function which happens in your neurons, and so it gives a signal to look at it. That's how the neurons also will need a activation function. Either it could be sigmoid, or it, there's so many hundreds of functions actually. Depends on your problem, you can have a function, and then you have an output. As simple as that. No training is required here. So let's see the bigger picture here. There's a machine learning. It has two types of learning. The methods, right? I told you, a kid, you can give him three devices and it keeps in the memory. Now next time when you provide him with some screen, he would be able to identify whether this screen is a mobile or a TV. Correct? If these are the two items you are giving him. If you give him something different, then he may not be able to identify it. So the training model is as simple as that. You provide certain training data to a model, which is called supervised learning. You label those, this is TV, this is mobile, this is car. So you label them and you tell the system, if you encounter these features, this is outcome should be identified as this. You train it. Next, you continue to provide different input data, so it is able to provide you the outcome according to the training that it has had. So supervising is this. Unsupervised, you don't really need to supply any labels. It is it learns by itself through the patterns and you know, gleaning through the data for the features and patterns. There are other iterations like, you know, semi-supervised and reinforcement. Reinforcement is where you put a robot in an unknown state and then it starts to gain points, or it loses the points based on, you know, the activity it does, the action it does, okay, the responses it does. It learns from it and it course corrects it over the time. Machine learning, this is supervised learning, this is unsupervised learning, wherein you have labels, where you provide labels as a supervisor, so the machine learns, and then next time when you input the data, the model automatically picks up and there is the classification, regression or whatever it is as per the model that you decided. Unsupervised, it goes to the data, it elicits some of the features using some patterns and the structure of the data. So support vector machines, this is one of the most popular algorithm. Imagine I said, you know, a individual was given a mobile and a TV, okay. What does it do? This model tries to separate those two, you know, inputs using a model called support vector machine. It creates a hyper hypervisor which actually separates the two support vectors. Support vectors means the nearest line you draw to one set of data points and also the opposite set of data points. And the maximum distance you have to arrive at, that is called, you know, hyperplane, maximum distance. So using this algorithm, you can arrive at the maximum distance between the two support vectors, that is the midpoint is called support hyperplane. And both sides you have distinctly different data which is actually representing features of those inputs that you have supplied. Okay, it is, for example, I just wanted to run through a few examples. Now imagine you have a mail system and you wanted to identify it is a spam or not. So it is simple classification. A given mail, is it spam or it is not a spam? So based on certain inputs you given in the training model, it will identify a system, a particular mail is a spam or not. That is what is important for us. If it is a spam, what do we want to do? We will go to the next one, right? So this is another model where decision tree, you would have a root node and an attribute is tested for various possibilities until you find, you know, the lowest point in that attribute, which is called leaf node. Okay, now for example, I have $100 and I'm hungry, and what do? If I'm either order on, you know, Swiggy, or I go to a restaurant and eat, but can I go to a restaurant and eat a meal for $100? Or with, can I also travel using this $100? So there are so many possibilities. So those data are fed into a decision system, and then a decision is arrived, like how we normally think a decision tree. Now for example, if you have to give in cyber security parlance, the system asks questions, 20 questions to identify whether it is a spam or malware. You can program the decision tree in such a way that it actually goes through a set of questionnaire, and decision tree will arrive at a, you know, outcome whether it is a malware or something else. So we can use machine learning to manage the security most effectively in many ways. Now k nearest neighbor is very, very popular. The two things, one is small k and one is large k. Large k is a linear way of looking at it. It uses Euclidean distance to identify the nearest data point, the new data point what you wanted to input. It will try to identify the distance between that and all other data points near to it. And you have a k. K is, you can arrive at a k, optimum k, which is which can identify it. It should always be odd number, by the way, and so that, you know, there is no, again, a confusion between whether it falls on one data point or feature side or the other feature side, right? So k is very, very important, and it is a simple Euclidean distance, that you straight line distance between that point and the other nearby points you identify to, and then you can simply classify that particular, you know, data has these features, so it is because its nearest neighbor, you know, we call it, right, birds of same feather flock together, as simple as that. What is small k? Small k is clustering. That is nonlinear again. Okay, that's very interesting, and usually what happens is this tends to get very slow if the data is very, very large. So we need to be careful about using this model in large data sets. Deep belief networks this is, you know, a hybrid kind of a model. You use AI algorithms with neural networks, and you know, the kind of deep neural network it is, it actually composed of restricted Boltzmann machines. Actually, instead of stacking hundreds of, you know, layers of hidden layers of neural network, you could use restricted Boltzmann machine to arrive at the same kind of a result, because they actually remove the multidimensionality and they try to do, you know, reduction of dimensionality, but yet preserves the probability function and provides you the outcomes. So the multi layers below the top layer, and it goes through, each layer goes through a learning phase independently, and then the outcome is arrived, which is called, you know, deep belief network outcome. Yeah. And one last thing, so where we can use it? We can use it in you know, prevention of security in the IoT, basically. This is most popular, you know, system which is coming up, and a lot of research is happening on this, and this is really, there's a lot of mass behind it. It may need one full day to even explain this model. The one is the convolutional neural network. It's mostly used, as Sar mentioned, we use it for image processing or voice identification and so many other applications, or night vision and so on. You have an input which is segmented into various data points, and it goes through multiple layers, at least four layers. And the convolutional layer, actually it actually manages a couple of parameters into a single mathematical function. And what you get, the output is, after the pooling, the image starts collecting the features, and the dimensionality comes down as you apply the ReLU function. Okay, rectified linear unit is a function, and then in the final stage you have a two dimensional matrix picture, which is by, you know, normalizing the output layer, you'll get a single dimensional pixel with much more deep features of the original image. Okay, where is it used? It is used in especially when Dr. Rajshekar mentioned that you know, Stuxnet, which is a malware which was used. Imagine the harm that it can cause. It wiped out entire Iranian nuclear reactors and 14 industrial estates. No guesses who has deployed that. It's very simple, all of us. It actually, you know, which actually is a very important point for all of us to know, that we have the technology today to use any of the gadgets in your house which can be talking to the internet, even for a brief while, and deploy the kind of a malicious code which can destroy your entire house. They destroyed, this malware was sitting in the campuses of 14 industrial estates in Iran for years, and it continuously destroyed the hardware. The nuclear reactors broke, the hydraulics broke, because the software that they deployed have completely rendered all nuclear operations and industrial estates around that, you know, completely useless. That's what can do. So this is one of the best uses for, you know, managing counter attacks for such malware. Okay, I just wanted to let you know, we spoke about a bit of classification. Given we have a spam, and you know classification, is a spam or not, you would use that SVM model and you identify that. Now imagine a situation where you have the spam, but you don't know whether it is harassment, whether it is adult content, or whether it is some threatening. Okay, you could have spam various categories the organization. So how do you know that? Then you do something like clustering, where it actually groups based on certain features and identify, hey, this mail, though is under spam, this is categorized as so and so, on basic some features. So likewise, you would have classification used in detection of frauds. You would have regression used in various other activities. Like, you know, regression, mostly you try to find what is the next step going to be if this is the previous behavior, right? It's a trend analysis or some kind of a thing. It all depends on what are the previous outcomes for the same, you know, events, and what could be the next event if this outcome has to happen, right? So we extrapolate the data and try to find possible fraud. There is a fraud detection, you can use regression so effectively. And the clustering, as I mentioned, we know the multiple spam mails, we don't know which category, you can cluster them to group individuals. So when you have more clarity of whether it's a threat mail or it is adult content or it is something else, you know appropriate action to take, right? Association is usually a behavior is associated with certain outcomes within, someone is accessing a database continuously. When it is, its role is not to access, correct, in the organization. So you would be able to see that is leading to some kind of a event which is not appropriate for the organization. Link prediction, again, we have, this is much more deeper analysis of position matrix factorization, which is used heavily now in understanding the behavior of malware. And RLNDL, as we discussed, it's mostly used in robotics and how do we manage a given situation, how do you train the robotics to perform the required outcomes. Deep learning, we have mostly, it is deployed in IDS and IPS, intrusion detection system and intrusion prevention systems, right? Mostly, because these things are happening on real time and signatures that you have in your database may not have a match, and you need to have a real time intelligence. Or what these companies do, they actually have a kind of sandbox, as you mentioned. They, if they think that there is a suspicious code, they put that code into the sandbox and apply all the systemic behaviors and find out whether it's harmful code or not. And if it is harmful, they hash it out, they provide a signature and put it in the standard database, so it can be classified as a malware. Okay, so this is only possible using artificial intelligence and deep learning. So we spoke about this triad: confidentiality, integrity, and availability. What is confidentiality? A person who is required to have access only will be given access, which is called authentication. You authenticate a person. Then you provide the level of access required. If you don't provide the required access, that is authorization, right? Authorization. If you don't give it, if you give too much of an access, what happens? It affects integrity, because you would have the rights to manipulate the data, correct? So integrity. So to manage integrity, you use encryption. To maintain confidentiality, you should have authentication, right? Authentication, again, you have dual factor authentication, you have multi-factor authentication. So the sky is the limit, depends on the system you want to protect. And availability. Availability is when you need to have access, it should be available. If it is taken down, like the parliament was taken down, is not available. So you have to have access to something when you need it. That is called availability. The most important thing we are lacking here is, I just want to give some thoughts also for you all to think about, accountability. Now, for example, GDPR, how many of you know what is GDPR? It's a global data protection, regulation, European Union. Means your personal data cannot be manipulated or used or transferred without your permission. Broadly, I'm putting it. There were data processors, there are data controllers, whatnot. Everybody collects, today in India, everybody collects your Aadhaar information, PAN information, and God knows what they do. We can't trust government, we can't trust telecom companies, because they sell your account details to all marketing agencies, right? Okay? So, accountability is lacking. In India, we talk about 40% of transactions, world, this is the highest, digital transactions happen only in India. And per capita consumption on data, mobile data, is highest in India. Imagine what we are, in front of, what kind of a challenge we have, and we do not have privacy laws. Yeah. So, I just leave a thought here for in the parliament. Ajay Kumar Sharma said we had 670,000 attacks this year, and Google says 18 million attacks in the quarter one. So, did Ajay Kumar apply convolution algorithm, or I did a classification mistake? You find out. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. It was extremely an informative session. May I now request CSR Prabhu sir and Rajshekar sir to felicitate Sri Venu Gopal garu.